that's a lot of damage!
Han, Daniel, Tulian, Meldanin, and thank you once again for joining me. My name is Lord Aramel, and today we will be starting episode 3 of Critical Role's second campaign. I know that this Thursday, campaign 3 will start, so I will be doing this episode and kind of wrapping up this kind of three part. I'm going to try, I think this Saturday, I will do a live stream at noon for Eastern Standard Time, just to kind of sum up my feelings about Critical Role in general and Campaign 2, as we have barely started. I realize that I'm just scratching the surface. But after that, I'm hoping to transition to Campaign 3. Not quite live, but as the episodes come out. And to help me bring along this series,
hi!
I am joined by Claren, who has spent a lot of time trying to get me to watch Critical Role. Claren here has seen the totality of Season 2, right?
Almost all of Campaign 2. I was able to catch up enough during the plague times that when they started back releasing episodes live, I was able to start watching them live. They are pre-recorded, and they're going to be doing that for Campaign 3 as well, but it was definitely an experience getting to watch the last 43 episodes of Campaign 2 as they came out. And I am very excited that this one is finally watching them, and we can do Campaign 3 as it comes out. So,
yes, so we will be watching tonight the first half of Campaign 2, The Mighty Nein, Episode 3, The Midnight Chase. So, without any further ado, let's get started. Sam's lip syncing is just entering into Uncanny Valley, and I'm not certain how I feel about it.
That's what everyone sees when we use tongues.
Yeah, so if you really want to mess with your players, make sure that they understand that the tongues spell... Is that in 5th Ed? I think it's in 5th Ed.
Yes, it
okay. is. Okay. So remember that the words that the player speaks and the words that people hear are not the same, so their lips will not look right. Fun DM trick. I'd like to hide behind 50 NPCs. That's my usual defense for social engagements. Man, I feel that. I feel that a lot. Oh no, I don't want to be a guard killer.
I don't want to be a fucking zombie, says Molly Mock, and me sitting here knowing things. If any of y'all watching have seen the rest of Campaign 2, you'll understand why I think that's fucking hilarious.
I'm worried, but I'm also more thinking about a month or so back. I don't want to be a guard killer. So we're pretty early in the combat, and Matt, being very cinematic to start off, had rushed to the zombies' turn, ignoring the actual initiatives that were just cast. He realized that, oh, this, I've goofed, and rewind, and I've been there. I've had similar things happening, so. That's another point in, for this being completely unscripted. So, there you go, right? I've been there, Matt. It's all good. Molly Mock's, ability here at, 2120.
The Blood Maledict.
Yeah, that's kind of creepy, not gonna lie. Kind of creepy. Okay. Okay.
Run up past the guard.
Oh!
The guard is brave. Right there, gonna pull out my falchion. Yeah.
Yeah!
And I'll flip it over so it's pommel.
So, the Texan half-orc just used Eldritch Blast. I got that right, right? Yeah.
Eldritch Blast.
Yeehaw. Yeehaw. Ooh, and Molly Mock hits the dirt. Ooh, that's,
Episode 3!
That's rough. Never good when somebody hits zero. The sight of seeing one of us die. I'm just unconscious. Nope,
nope, dead forever. Forever. Me, sitting over here.
No spoilers.
I know!
So, can I use medicine? Well, do you have a inhaler kit? I have donuts and paint.
Something you'll learn about Jester is she always has pastries on hand. Always. Sweet pastries. That's like her whole MO.
They probably know this better than I do.
It's Jester, you know? It's Jester.
Well, either way, it does make me think of all the random things that player characters will pick up over the course of a campaign. Kneecaps. Very quick side note. They are definitely playing Elder Scrolls Oblivion music, and it gave me a flashback. Completely unrelated to this, but I like it. I like it. This is a good plan. It's definitely not going to backfire. Let's go.
We love Jester. And her optimism.
I've heard similar things. Sometimes they even did work. Sometimes. I get out and I arrange the bodies so that they look like they might have been having a romantic tryst. I've heard this one before. You didn't do it, but I know that What campaign was it? There have definitely been times where people have done similar things with enemies' bodies. Actually, I think one time Rin, they killed like a whole bunch of goblins in their camp, and they struck them up in odd poses, and one, like, three of them with, like, cards. It is kind of gruesome and yet very artistic.
But you know, they were just friends. They were just friends.
They were roommates.
Oh my god, they were roommates.
If two zombies make out, is it necrophilia? The role playing in this is great, and I thoroughly enjoy the Nott and Caleb dynamic that they've got going on. I mean, all the dynamics are fun and entertaining, and I'm just, it's some good stuff. Some good stuff. I love to see it. So, Ford, you're a sailor, huh? You're very acquainted with seamen, huh? The look that is currently being shot across that table. I like it. Are there clusters of semen around you? Is that how you talk to one another? Oh God, why? I just unpaused. So here we are at 1 hour, 39 minutes, and Matthew Mercer puts in a solid several second facepalm, and yeah, that was me a few hours ago, so oops. That DM facepalm, I feel. I'm a little bit suspicious whenever I hear somebody in a thick Russian accent, kind of glaring at the other person, say, I'm a very generous person. Like, that feels dangerous. Oof. And Kari now has tentacles. dwarfed indigos. What?
What? What?
Okay, so we're 2 hours in. They're escaping. He's probably going to call a break here soon, but I wanted to pause it almost exactly 2 hours anyways, just to be, you know, extra precise. You good?
Yeah. Okay. Put my hair back over.
Yeah, there you go. But yeah, this is interesting. A little bit worrying in some ways, and oh man, there was... Not how I would have handled the guards' bodies, I'll be honest. I would have definitely tried to concoct something like, oh, the cart ran off and, you know, the guards chased after it, and have Orna say that. But, you know, that's, you know, coming up with a good bluff is important, and you can probably squeeze advantage out of your DM if you roleplay well enough. Just tidbit for you. I mean, I've done similar, and for you all, right?
Yes, although I cannot come up with a specific example right now.
Right.
But there have been times when we'll be doing some sort of shenaniganry, and it's, hey, because of this specific thing that we just talked about in character, can I have advantage on this, or
a bonus of some kind.
An extra plus something. Right. So,
but yeah, it's getting good. It's getting interesting. That's for sure. It is a lot to watch at one time. And I look forward to a time when I can just have this kind of going in more of the background as I do other things. That is my hope for, we'll talk more after, let's see, so on Thursday I will do part two, and then Saturday I'll kind of wrap it up in a nice little bow, and give my full reaction, I guess, to the first three episodes of Critical Role. This is a not too bad of an episode length. So, Antonio Tulien Mildini, thank you once again for joining me. Thank you, Claire, for joining
me. Of course, anytime. Yeah. I'll never say no to watching Crit Roll with you.
Right. Until next time, friends, farewell. At 10 XP for listening to the DM Ramble. Did anybody level up?